welcome to Money, 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 your weekly personal finance date with me, Surabhi Upadhyay. It's tax season. Yes, March is here. And that means you've got just 4 more weeks to ensure that you've taken all possible tax benefits and legitimate deductions to minimize the tax pain before the financial year ends. So joining me today on the show to give you a quick tax checklist is Mayur Shah, partner EY, as well as Chetan Chandak of H&R Block. Gentlemen, great to have you here. I know, your expertise is in great demand this season, particularly as all salaried individuals are trying to make sure that, they're not missing out on something. So Mayur, let me start with you first.
Sure.
We were hoping that, life will look better come next financial year. That's not really happened in this budget. So let's work with what we have for the current fiscal. Your just broad thoughts on what is the one thing that you tell people when they're looking at tax planning and looking at being very efficient when it comes to their tax liability?
So for me, tax planning, there are a couple of aspects. Is that, you plan your investment in a manner which offers you better tax incentive benefits, so that, whatever investment you make, you can make maximum return out of that, including saving on tax cost. The second aspect is that, many a times we do incur certain expenditure which can provide us certain benefits, but we do not maintain documents or evidence to show that these expenses are incurred in this respect, and therefore, may miss out on those deductions. So let me give you an example that, you are one is making donations, and donation receipt do contain certificate whether this donation is eligible for deductions or not, and it has a validity period. In absence of that, the tax authority is very likely to deny the benefit. The third aspect and very important aspect, which I believe is most important from a tax planning perspective, is that certain times we do not report certain things which can increase tax or penalties on us, and which can we can avoid. Like, currently all ordinary residents are required to disclose their certain assets. Giving an example that, I as a, IT consultant go outside India, open a bank account outside India, and I do not report that bank account. May not be, nothing will be taxable therein. But non-disclosure could levy a penalty on me.
Okay.
And hence, one should ensure that not only saving taxes, but avoiding penalty is also a kind of a planning for me.
Okay. So let's get started with Chetan. Chetan, let's take up the bulk of, ATC. That's pretty much the only solace that salary taxpayers have, this 1.5 lakh rupee list of deductions. So if you could just quickly, go over the checklist and tell us exactly what all is covered under ATC.
See, the major benefits to a salaried individual is in the form of ATC deductions. So under that, you have many options available, starting with your PPF account, Employees Provident Fund, then your the investment in Sukanya Samruddhi Yojana, then the 5 years fixed deposits with either post office or bank, or ELSS equity linked savings schemes, and your children's tuition fee. So these are all the list of investments or the expenses which qualifies for ATC deduction, including your housing loan principal repayment, your stamp duty and registration charges which you pay on your registration of your home. So all these qualify for ATC deductions. And there are many other like government securities. There are a few government securities which qualifies for ATC benefits as well.
Okay, let me ask some follow-up questions, Mayur, on this. The ATC category itself, while of course all kinds of life insurance policies you are taking, the premium that you're paying on them, they will be covered, ULIPs are going to be covered. I'm looking at the clause which talks about contribution to a pension scheme. Because for the NPS, there is a additional 50,000 deduction over and above this 1.5 lakh limits. But what sort of pension schemes are covered under the ATC limit, the 1.5 lakh limit?
So there are two kinds of pension scheme. One which we contribute to statutory provident fund. Then the other one is superannuation scheme, which is again a kind of a pension scheme. And there is another provision which where it falls within the limit of 1.5 lakh, where any pensions which are being bought from the market, which are being registered with IRDA, those pension schemes are also covered therein.
So any kind of annuity that you
annuity
might be buying,
which you can buy,
okay,
would get covered therein.
Okay.
So these are the products which are getting covered under 8IC and other provisions which are limiting the entire deduction to 1.5 lakh, apart from NPS.
Okay. Now, Chetan, of course, mentioned the principal amount that you're repaying. If you've taken a home loan and you're repaying your principal, so 1.5 lakh rupees every year is taken care of in the ATC category. But let's talk about the other aspects, the interest that you'd be repaying, and also the additional deduction that is being offered to those who are buying smaller houses. So if your ticket size is just, I think, 50 lakh rupees, if the loan amount is 35 lakhs, then you get an additional deduction. So run us through some of those provisions as well.
Yeah. So there are, you know, a couple of things. One, where any property which is being bought and you are paying interest on borrowed funds which are being borrowed for buying a property. Now, if it is self-occupied property, then you get a deduction only limited to 2 lakh rupees. But if this property is being let out or is being considered as deemed to have been let out, the deduction can be of any amount of interest. And such interest or a loss which is being incurred on house property can be set off against any source of income.
Like all good things come to an end, this good news also comes to an end. This is the last financial year, right?
Absolutely right. You are absolutely bang on point. So, you know, this is going to end from this year onwards. So, you know, this is the deduction which you can claim. And as you rightly mentioned, for you know, interest up to 50,000 is available for deduction under Section 8IE, where the condition is that, you know, the ticket size of the house is only 50 lakhs, whereas loan thereon should not exceed 35 lakhs. But now that deduction is also available only for this year, and next year onwards, I don't think it will be available.
I think it's available only on loans that have been sanctioned in a particular year.
That is from 15 to 16.
15 to 16. Okay. So, yeah, if your loan has been sanctioned in that year, if the amount is not more than 35 lakhs, if the house ticket size, the property is not above 50 lakhs, then you get additional deduction. So, total deduction is 2.5 lakhs.
2.5 lakhs.
So, Mayur, quick point on the loss component that we're talking about, because it's only available for this year. But there is a provision to carry forward that loss, right? For the next several years.
Sure. So, what you are talking about is that going forward, what will happen if the loss is limited to 2 lakh rupees? And if I have an excess loss, what should I do with it? Yes, such losses to be carried forward for next 8 years.
Okay.
And such loss can be set off only against income from house property. So in subsequent year, if you have any income arising from house property, this loss can be set off only against that you know, that income. If there is no income, and very unlikely that people will be able to generate income within 8 years' time, then it is a lost cause.
Mayur, let's do this with an example, because this is a changing provision and a lot of people will want to understand the math. So this year, of course, whatever is my loss, I can, you know, claim the entire amount as deduction. Let's talk about next financial year onwards. Supposing I have a loss of around 9 lakh rupees because of the interest that I've paid on this loan. I can only claim, or I can only claim a deduction of up to 2 lakhs, right? There is a balance amount of 7 lakhs, which gets carried forward. But then how does it work? I mean, how will I set it off in the subsequent years?
Sure. So what is happening is that, you know, your loss from income from house property is around 9 lakhs. And 2 lakhs will be adjusted against your salary income or income from other sources.
Okay.
Balance 7 lakhs, you will carry forward it to the next year. What happens in the next year, income from house properties, assuming it is there, say up to 5 lakhs, then what happens is that 7 lakhs loss which was carried forward from the last year, out of which you will take 5 lakhs and adjust against income which has been there from house property.
So here is my other question, that your total loss in the subsequent year was 7 lakhs. Can you use the entire amount to offset the income from house, or will that be capped at 2 lakhs as well in the subsequent year?
No. So as far as if you are adjusting this loss against income from house property, there are no limits.
Okay.
So therefore, there are no limits of 2 lakh which will apply in this situation.
Okay.
However, if any loss which is there, which is to be set off against any other heads, then the limit of 2 lakhs will apply and not otherwise.
Okay, fair enough. So that's a lot about taxation with respect to loans and housing. We have to take a break. There are lots of other heads, and make sure you've run your checklist through them as well. Whether you are taking medical insurance, if there's a disability in your household, if there are any specified ailments, there are tax benefits that you should take advantage of, and we'll discuss them on the other side of the break.